Howdy folks, DIY repair day today, unfortunately, not by choice. This is a GE profile. This would apply to a lot of them. Our refrigerator is running a fever. Don't know what kind of virus it might have. Just show you what's going on here. Just gonna zoom into our temperature setting at the top. Okay, this says it's 37. If we actually take a temperature, reading with the old IR gun here, as you can see, we're in the high 50s. My wife's, geez, up to 60 now. My wife's taken out all the top shelves, but if we zoom down to a drawer here, let's just look at the deli drawer. Oh, you can see that, but it's sitting right around 30. So nice and cold in there. So putting our diagnostic troubleshooting caps on, what does that tell us? This is one of these dual evaporator refrigerators. A lot of them are like this now. You've got one compressor, and you've got the condenser coil and a squirrel cage. You've got a fan blowing through it, and then you've got two evaporators, one for the freezer section and a smaller one for the refrigerator section. And on this specific side-by-side, what happens is there is a fan that draws air from the bottom. This is right behind the lowest part of the refrigerator, behind that second shelf way down there, so we've got to pull all that out too to fault trace this. And my guess is this fan is shot, so all the cold air is pooling at the bottom perhaps. Yeah, my guess is because they've got these big, the air is being drawn through the bottom and it comes up through this ductwork at the back and blows out the top, or at least it should, and it's not doing that. The fan is running, but what the problem is the evaporator is frozen solid. So it can't pull any air across it and up through the tunnel. Now the question is, why is this evaporator frozen solid? My guess is the temperature sensor is shot. We've had a problem with this fridge once before, about 5 years ago, where the evaporator wasn't running at all. And it was because the temperature sensor had failed. So there's one behind the evaporator and there's also one up right here behind this little button. It's got vents in it, but I can't even get this off. I've got the screws out, but this is all frozen solid in here. Cold as a gold digger's heart. So I'm gonna have to get a hairdryer out to melt this. Okay, so I finally got it out, heated it up with a blow dryer. And as you can see, just totally caked. And there's the fan that is pulling air across that evaporator and then up through the ductwork. Gonna have to thaw this entire thing out to go any further. Yeah, so if you're wondering where all this water goes, drips down to this tray, goes through this funnel, down into a tray underneath the condenser. I gotta tell you, that took a long time to thaw out, even with the hairdryer. At any rate, here is the temperature sensor for the evaporator. It goes in a little hole at the back here. I'd use my little mirror to see it. It just slides out. You have to pull the evaporator off the back of the fridge. There's just two screws that hold it on. But there's some wiggle room. At least you can get back there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut this off. As you can see, there's already a splice here. Like I said, this has been replaced before and these seem to fail. I don't know if this is the cause. I'm just going by past experience that this has failed before, and so is that other one up in the fridge. I'm just gonna cut this off. I've got this all turned off, but this is low voltage stuff. We're gonna go down to the workbench and see if this is working. You need a digital multimeter on the ohm scale, and it gives a specific resistance at a specific temperature. Let's see what we've got here. So we've got our little temperature sensor, which is just a thermistor. It's at ambient temperature now. I've got it hooked up to my multimeter in the ohm scale, and it's reading 5.1 kilo-ohms, and it's sitting at about 55 Fahrenheit. Now, to find out if that's in range, let's just look online here. I just did a Google search for GE temperature sensor testing, and the site came up, and at 68 Fahrenheit, it should be reading about 6.2 kilo-ohms, and at freezing 32 Fahrenheit, it should be reading 16.3 kilo-ohms. So that's what we want to go by. Now this is a little bit cooler. It's cool in the shop right now, but we've got a glass of ice water, which is sitting at right around freezing, 30 degrees Fahrenheit. So this is reading, I think, a little bit low, but we'll fire this in here, and it'll take a few minutes to stabilize. But as you can see, the resistance is climbing, so the colder the sensor gets, the higher the resistance becomes. It's been about 5 minutes or so. It seems to be stabilizing. You know, wiggle it around, make sure there's no intermittence. But seems to be stabilizing at 8.14 kilo-ohms, and that's way too low. In ice water, the specs say it should be approximately 16.3. So yeah, it's roughly half of what it should be. So it's no wonder that the evaporator had frozen up. The fridge thought it was way warmer than it was, so it just kept running and running and running, trying to cool down. So we know this sensor is shot. Now, I've got a new one. These, I'll put a link to these at the bottom, but they're all the same for the GE, and I think a lot of fridges. The part number, ignore the ER, it's probably just the manufacturer, but the number you want to look up is WR55X10025. And there's aftermarket ones, you can get GE ones. The ones that I've got in there now, I've always had GE. This is an aftermarket. See if it works any better. And just to give you an idea, we'll hook this one up to the meter. Well, I don't think we have to wait any longer. It's been about a minute or two. And yeah, it's still climbing. They're saying, what, 16.3 kOhms at 0 Celsius, 32 Fahrenheit. And we're climbing right up there. This one was half that value. So we know this sensor is shot. So let's get this thing put into the fridge. So we've got our new sensor, and we're just going to solder it, splice it onto the wiring that is coming out of the back of the fridge cabinet. Now, of course, you're going to need a soldering iron for this. I'm just using my little Miniware TS100. And most importantly, the heat shrink that you put on this, I'm just going to put regular heat shrink over each of these ends to insulate the soldering connections. But then I'm also going to have some of this adhesive lined heat shrink to go over the whole works after I'm done. And this will seal. This has got a basically a hot glue inside it, and when it shrinks, the hot glue heats up and melts, and it will seal all around the wiring so no moisture can get into it. And that's very important. If moisture migrates into these wires, it can take out the sensor. And if you don't have adhesive lined heat shrink, a little trick that I have used to get by is just to use regular heat shrink, but before you slide it over the wire and heat it, coat the wire in a little bit of hot glue all the way around. Let the hot glue solidify, slide regular heat shrink over, heat it, and then the heat shrink will melt, the hot glue will melt, and it will give you an environmentally sealed connector as well. So that's another trick you can use if you don't have any of this adhesive line stuff. So we're just going to strip a little bit off. We don't need much. Try not to get it in the evaporator like I just did. Not much room to work with a camera in here. And we'll do the same with our sensor wire. Now I'm just going to solder these up real quick. I got to move the camera, sorry guys, I just can't get in here. I'll come back when I have them soldered. Make sure you fire the heat shrink over before you solder these together. I'm just going to tin them and do a tinned butt joint. Okay, I've just got the wire splices done. Soldered them up real nice. We'll just slide the little pieces of heat shrink over first. I'm just going to do one at a time. So I have those on, and then there's the adhesive lined adhesive heat shrink down by the bulb of the sensor. Put this guy on. Okay, so that's just to insulate the connectors from touching. There's no polarity on this. And now we'll slide the adhesive heat shrink over. Get it centered. Now you can tell that's fully melted when you don't see any more air pockets in it, and you'll see adhesive oozing out the ends. Focus, you bugger. So we'll slide the bulb back in. Sorry, I just cannot show you that because the camera won't fit back there. But there's a little hole down at the bottom that the sensor slides into. We'll button this back up and we'll see if it's, it'll take several hours, maybe even overnight. It's, 8:30 right now. Probably won't be able to tell till tomorrow morning if it's working. So everything's buttoned back together. This is a great time to clean out the fridge, of course, wipe everything off. And I just wanted to show something. This fridge is about 12, 13 years old, obviously before LED fridge lighting came out, but that doesn't mean you can't get LED lights to replace the hot incandescents that were in the fridge. And that's what we've done with this one. Put an LED bulb down there, two up there, and two on the roof. Come on, there you go. So I'll just get this bad boy back together and come back tomorrow morning and see where the temperature's at. Hopefully it's all fixed. It's been about 13, 14 hours. Already got it restocked and I think we got our beat here. Got the temperature set to 37, and I don't know if you can see that. We're sitting between 40 down to, if we look, go into the shelf, we're sitting around 36. So now if this didn't work, probably what I'd do is I'd replace the other temperature sensor on the side here. And then if that didn't even work, then yeah, I'd probably suspect the motherboard. They're not that much, maybe $120 for this particular model. Definitely check those sensors first. They seem to be a known commodity that fails. I'm gonna order another one up, maybe even two. Seems every 5 years. I don't know if that's typical or not. So hopefully that helped you out. If you're thinking of doing this, you know, a lot of us are in self-isolation, mandatory, lockdown, that kind of stuff because of the pandemic. This is a great time to do DIY projects. Let's face it, a lot of us, money is getting tight now. You know, my wife got laid off a couple of weeks back because of it. It's kind of a crappy time, but it's a good time to do DIY projects. You know, penny saved, penny earned. And another thing I'm going to do with this fridge now that I've got the time, I'm going to be pulling it out and vacuuming off the condenser underneath it. We've got a couple of dogs and hair gets back there and it'll plug the condenser up and just makes it run a lot less efficient. So that'll be the next project to do. Take care, folks. Thanks for watching. Stay safe. Stay healthy.